Can protein replete glycogen on a low-carb diet? Hi, I'm Chris Masterjohn, and I have a PhD in nutritional sciences. I am not a medical doctor, and nothing contained in this episode may be construed as medical or nutritional advice of any kind or a substitute, therefore. This episode is meant purely as scientific education. If you wish to act on any ideas presented in this episode, please consult your physician first and never take anything herein as a reason to contradict medical advice. With that said, enjoy the episode.
Felipe's fourth question is, if someone eats an extremely high protein yet low carb diet, is it possible to significantly or at all replete liver glycogen through the gluconeogenesis from all the excess amino acids? Yes, it's possible. And I don't know exactly what the dosing is, but I think it's totally possible. It comes at the risk, and don't want to say risk, but at the downside of creating a lot more ammonia. But I think it's quite possible. And I think that, you know, when you're looking at that, in fact, and I think it was Master Nutrition Energy Metabolism Lesson 17, I think. It was the one on the evidence around low-carb and athletic performance. And if you look at the studies suggesting low-carb does not compromise athletic performance, the diets are much higher protein than the diets that suggest that it does compromise athletic performance or glycogen levels. And so I think on a low-carb diet, protein is going to probably be a very critical determinant of glycogen levels. I would point out that there is probably some advantage to getting glycogen from carbs instead of from protein, in the sense of you might be winding up with greater cortisol levels, you might be winding up with greater ammonia levels, you may or may not be effectively compensating for that ammonia with the urea cycle. Some people with genetic polymorphisms in the urea cycle might be stressing that system out a bit. You might be creating more acid-base balance issues than you would otherwise have. An acid-base balance, if you increase acidity, you're increasing muscle catabolism. So it's not necessarily the best thing for your muscles. You might be generating more sulfite. You might need more molybdenum. You might wind up with sulfite issues. You might be altering the microbiome in unfavorable ways towards more sulfur metabolizing bacteria. So I don't think it comes without potential costs, but I do think that enough protein will be very good for your glycogen on a low-carb diet. Thank you, Felipe, for your question.
This episode was part of a Q&A for members of the CMJ MasterPass, a buyer's club with exclusive and massive discounts on your favorite premium foods and health products, including pasture-raised and wild meat and seafood, supplements, sleep accessories, water filters, phototherapy devices, and much more. As a bonus, you also get to participate in monthly private Zoom Q&As with me. You can join the MasterPass at chrismasterjohnphd.com/masterpass and use the code Q&A, spelled out as Q-A-N-D-A, Q&A, for a 10% lifetime discount. For the remainder of 2020, I will be working full-time on finishing my Vitamins and Minerals 101 book while reserving a portion of my time for consulting clients. You can pre-order my book at chrismasterjohnphd.com/book. In my consulting, I am neither a medical practitioner nor a coach. I serve as your data analyst and your strategist. I teach you scientific principles of health and wellness, help you analyze your data, and help brainstorm actionable strategies. You can sign up for a consultation at chrismasterjohnphd.com/consultations. I will try to respond to comments here when I can, but my presence will be intermittent while I'm finishing my book. I hope you enjoyed this, and I will see you in the next episode.